Well, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, everybody. Welcome to Grace. Grace is here to bring God's grace to your life. We want you to know more fully the depth of God's love, His grace, and His mercy as we say goodbye to 1 year and ring in the new. And so welcome as we gather around God's Word and at His table. Just a few things before we begin our time of worship. Make sure you grab the grace notes on your way out. They're on the announcement wall. That's going to kind of give you the full detail of all that's coming as we kind of get back into the regular swing of things. And so the grace notes are there for you. Just a few highlights in regards to all the beautification of grace during the Christmas season, these beautiful poinsettias. If you purchased a poinsettia in honor or memory of somebody, take them today. We'd love for you to have them in your possession. And so come up, and the ladies will be here after worship, and they'll help you kind of get that all sorted. And I don't know if they have bags and stuff to help put them in, but whatever. Just come and grab a poinsettia, and they're yours to take home for all of you with that. There is an anniversary celebration that's taking place on January 20th, and so make sure you check either the website, the URL code that's there for you, or the grace notes gives you all the details regarding that coming up January 20th. We have a birthday boy here today, Logan. There he is. I know. Happy birthday, brother. All right. Let's sing happy birthday to Logan as his family laughs and giggles as we sing happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Listen, Logan, after church, you could come up and blow out all the candles. Just to kind of feel like you're in the spirit of it. All right. Today we have the joy of having Deacon Terry Bauer proclaim God's word today. We're going to consider what it is that in the fullness of time, God sent Jesus for our redeeming. And so we pray God's blessing as we focus our hearts in God's word today. Let's stand and begin our worship as we call our hearts to worship with the Christmas hymn, O Come All You Faithful. Christ the Savior is born, and our Redeemer lives. At just the right time, God sent His Son into the world and has now sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts. We have been adopted as the sons and daughters of God. Let's pray. Lord, we gather this morning in the joy that in the fullness of time, you came to save, to redeem. So bring by your Spirit the joy and the comfort and the peace that is ours, that our Savior has come. Fill this worship and the beginning of our new year with all that is ours in you. We pray it all in Jesus' name. God has adopted us as sons and daughters and cherishes our relationship with him. As we begin this new year, we go to him as his children and confess our sins, trusting he will restore us. Heavenly Father, we come before you with humble hearts to acknowledge our sin. Our hearts cry out, Abba, Father. We confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and our hearts cry out, Abba, Father. We confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart, and our hearts cry out, Abba, Father. We confess that we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves, and our hearts cry out, Abba, Father. Your Father has heard your cry and has forgiven your sin. He is the perfect Father, and his love for you is unconditional and everlasting. Go into this new year with the good news that Christ the Savior has come, and in him and through him, your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Forgiven and free. Let's sing our song of praise, the Christmas Hallelujah. Thank you. peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Thank you so much. You may be seated. All right, let's have all the kids come forward. Come on up, you guys, for the children's message. All right, now, we got one more rolling in. There we go. Okay, everybody, tell me, think back just a little bit. Oh, there we go. Freya and Fiona. Hi, girls. All right, tell me what you have recently held in your arms. Have you ever held, what are you holding on to recently, maybe since Christmas? Anything you're holding on to? Food. Not for long, though. Scoop it up and down it goes. Yeah, you and me both, buddy. Okay, anything else you're holding on to that you hold? Yes.
Nintendo Switch.
Yeah. You get a video game, you pull that in your hands, because that's a precious gift. Yes. A baby. Yeah, you got a new baby in your house, so you get to hold babies. Yeah, in your arms. Anything else you guys have held on to this Christmas? Yeah. A Pokemon card binder with all your Pokemon cards. Nice. Nice. Yeah. Well, we're going to hear of a time when people were in church. They gathered together, and we even know their names, Simeon and Anna. And guess what they got to hold?
Jesus.
Jesus, yeah. Mary and Joseph, when Jesus was just a baby, in fact, he was only 8 days old, not very old, and they brought Jesus to the temple as part of what they did. It was this beautiful moment where they come and they bring Jesus, the baby Jesus, and Simeon grabs Jesus and holds him in his arms and is filled with such great joy. Now listen, it is fun to hold all of our toys, things that we got, and wonderful gifts. But what a joy it was for Simeon to hold Jesus in his arms. The Savior of the world was a tiny little baby. And that's what we celebrate still this Christmas and throughout all of our lives, that God is with us, that he came even to places where people were waiting and they held him. And so Jesus comes to us as we hear his word, as we know and hear that he loves and cares about you, and maybe, just maybe, we get to hold Jesus in our hearts and to know that love all our lives long. Now, you're going to get to hold something special because there is a great Sunday school in store for you. Abby and Curtis are here. There they are. And you guys can go to children's Sunday school. Go ahead. Off you go if you'd like. You're welcome to go. Fiona's not quite sure. You can take her back, Mom, if you want. Yep. There we go. Now, they're going to be celebrating the joy of the Lord as in the beginning of this new year and the Christmas celebration that God is with us. They're making maracas. So we might have a conga line going up to communion. We'll see how that turns out. No, we won't do that. But yeah. We are going to turn our hearts and our minds to God's most holy and precious word as he speaks these words of hope and joy and peace into our lives. From Isaiah chapter 61. I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God. For he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom adorns his head, like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. 4. As the soil makes the sprout come up and the garden causes seeds to grow, so the sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent. For Jerusalem's sake, I will not remain quiet till her righteousness shines out like the dawn.
her salvation like a blazing torch. The nations will see your righteousness, and all kings your glory. You will be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will bestow. You will be a crown of splendor in the Lord's hand, a royal diadem in the hand of your God. And our second reading is from Galatians chapter 4. This will be the basis for Deacon Terry Bauer's message to us today. But when the time had fully come, God sent his Son, born of a woman born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive the full rights of sons. Because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And since you are a son, God has made you also an heir. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God in honor of our God who is with us, our Emmanuel. Let's stand for the gospel as we hold these words by God's Spirit in our hearts. From Luke chapter 2. When the time of their purification according to the law of Moses had been completed, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord, to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. Now, there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout, and he was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for the glory to your people Israel. Now the child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. And a sword will pierce your own soul too. There was also a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. And she was very old, and she had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then was a widow until she was 84. She had never left the temple, but worshiped night and day, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking toward the redemption, forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. When Joseph and Mary had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong and was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let's remain standing for our song of the day, Joy to the World.
Be seated. As we begin, won't you take a moment and pray with me, please? Father, I thank you for the privilege you give us to be still and know that in the midst of all the confusion and chaos in this world, that you are God, and that from the beginning there has been your word, the word made flesh, the word given by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the word alive. So it is that word to which we come this morning, seeking humbly your truth for the living of these days. Still our hearts and quiet our minds and sharpen our hearing so that we might hear your lesson for each of us in our own unique circumstances. All the honor and glory are yours, Father. Amen. Well, about 12 hours, we'll be turning the page on 2023 and stepping into 2024. If you're like me, now begins a three-month-long attempt to put the right date on my checks when I write those things. My guess is that at some point in the next couple of days, a question will come to your mind. What will 2024 be like? What will it bring? Think back for me for a moment, if you will, to New Year's Eve 2019. What did we know then? Well, we knew 2020 was a leap year. We knew that it was an election year. We knew that political wrangling that we had been experiencing at that time would only intensify. We knew there was seemingly small wars going on around the world, particularly in the Middle East. What we didn't know was that something we were just starting to learn about, called Wuhan flu, would rapidly spread, become known as COVID-19, and drive most everything that happened and didn't happen in year 2020. In addition, we didn't know that a seemingly routine police stop would lead to the death of George Floyd and trigger demonstrations and then intensify the breakdown in race relations in our country. But it did. We could easily say that 2020 was driven by events that we didn't see coming on December 31st, 2019. What about today? What might we say is our outlook for 2024? Well, again, it's leap year. Again, we're facing elections this year. Political wrangling has continued to escalate and seems like it's at an all-time high. And with the politicians going back and forth in a way that they look at us, sometimes it feels like they're the potters and we're the clay. The war between Hamas and Israel brings us such sad pictures every day. Days of destruction, death, and misplaced families. It also is giving us a taste of it at home, of the ugly face of anti-Semitism. We haven't seen it like this before. And then there's the fighting in the Ukraine. And we ask, when will that end? And our college campuses seem to be ground zero for demonstrations anymore. All this begs the question, what else is out there waiting for us this year? With all that's going on around us, all the pressures and expectations we carry with us as individuals, I guess it comes to no surprise how I hear the plea, come Lord Jesus, again and again, more often than ever before. After all, the Bible tells us that Jesus himself is recorded in Matthew 24 as saying that we will hear of wars and rumors of wars. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places, and lawlessness will be increased, all before he comes again. In today's epistle readings from Galatians, we heard the Apostle Paul say, "But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you're sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. And so that you are no longer a son, and if a son, then you are an heir through God." It started off by saying, "But in the fullness of time." That's an interesting phrase. There are several places in the Bible where it's repeated or something very close to that. It seems to mean that from the beginning of time, God had planned and expected for Jesus to come into the world to claim his people as his own, but only when everything was made right. Let's consider for a few moments the story of the manger. Waiting for Jesus' birth was much longer than just 9 months. It was several thousand years. It all started about 4,000 years ago when God appeared to a Middle Eastern nomad named Abraham. God told Abraham to leave his country, his relatives, and everything that was familiar to him so he could go to a land that God would show him. God promised Abraham that he would make him into a great nation, and from Abraham's seed, all the nations of the earth would be blessed. That seed, of course, would be Jesus. Abraham believed and obeyed God, spent the rest of his life waiting for that promise to be fulfilled. Nothing much happened for 600 years. Abraham's descendants were indeed many, but they were hardly a blessing. After centuries of multiplying in Egypt, Abraham's descendants became a real threat to Pharaoh. Pharaoh then forced them into slavery. God raised up a man named Moses to deliver these people from Pharaoh and lead them to the border of the promised land. God came to Moses with a promise. He said, "I will raise up a prophet from among their countrymen like you, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him." All through the years, God has raised up many prophets after Moses, but people still waited for this special promised prophet. Once they arrived in the promised land, God's people waited another 400 years until God raised up a king named David. David wanted to build a house for God, but God said no and offered to build something even greater for David. God said, "I will raise up your descendant after you, who will come forth from you, and I will establish his kingdom in your house, and your kingdom shall endure before me forever. Your throne shall be established forever." Jesus would fulfill that promise. When he entered Jerusalem on the first Palm Sunday, the crowd shouted, "Hosanna in the highest to the Son of David." But David waited and never saw the promise fully fulfilled. The fact is, David's immediate descendants made a huge mess out of things. 400 years later, the nation of Israel was split in two. Both the northern and the southern kingdoms had forsaken God and were in exile, facing possible life for the nation in the coming of the one called Messiah, who would deliver his people and restore them to glory. Isaiah wrote, "The Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel. For to us a son is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end." Well, it wasn't for another 500 years before that prophecy was fulfilled. A remnant of the nation of Israel had returned to the promised land, but it was hardly a glorious return. They were under the rule of Rome. The memory of promises made to Abraham, Moses, David, and Isaiah were still alive and well in the hearts of many Jews, but God's people were still waiting. It was into this darkness that the Christmas event finally came to pass. The fullness of time had been reached, and it was more than a 9-month wait. God's people had experienced 2,000 years of waiting. And after all these years, God finally sent to earth the one who could bring these promises to pass. Again, Galatians 4:4 tells us, in the fullness of time, God sent his son. A few verses earlier, Paul compared the timing of Christ's birth to the time a boy reached manhood in Jewish society. He said it's only when a young man comes of age that he can really experience the privileges of sonship. So when Paul said that God has sent his son in the fullness of time, you might say that the world had come of age. Great. But why was this the right time for God to send Jesus? Well, for one thing, it was the right time politically. The Roman Empire was at its height. Now, while it certainly had its flaws, Rome did offer good roads, a fair system of government, and peace. People could travel with relative ease, making it possible for news to spread rapidly throughout the land. Years later, when early Christians needed to take the message of Jesus to the far reaches of the empire, it would be far easier than at any time earlier in history. It was also the right time culturally. Greek language and culture brought an element of cohesion to society. More people were being educated and were able to read than ever before. But most of all, it was the right time spiritually. The average citizen of Rome was tired of the same old religion. Even the Jews were hungry for something more. The Pharisees tried to get folks back to a form of Judaism based on strict understanding of the Old Testament. However, it seems that deep down most people knew they couldn't live up to that. People longed for a true relationship with God that was about more than just keeping the law. But when you really stop to think about it, when Jesus was finished with his life and ministry, on the surface, very few things had changed. It seemed where people were still waiting. Sure, Jesus had performed miracles, had a group of devoted followers, but when compared to the promises made about the coming Messiah, much still had not come to pass. God promised them land, but when Jesus ascended, the land was still occupied by Rome. They expected a Messiah to deliver them from Rome's rule. He didn't do that. A few years later, even Jerusalem and its temple would be leveled to the ground, and again, God's people scattered. Even the New Testament writers seemed to expect something more. In Philippians chapter 2, Paul wrote that the time would come when every knee would bow and every tongue confess that Jesus was Lord. What happened to that? The Apostle John in Revelation 2:14 pointed to a time when death and mourning and crying and pain would be no more. Show me a place like that today. Sort of like the fulfillment of his kingdom and his promises will come in two installments. It's like God sent his son. He lived a sinless life, went to the cross as payment for our sins, and then rose from the dead 3 days later. But stop. Let's look at Galatians once again. Verse 5 through 7, it says, Jesus came to redeem those who are under the law so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. Adopted. We're adopted. John Frame, in his book Systematic Theology, says, and I quote, adoption is the apex, the high point of our relationship with God. Adoption, belonging to God's family, is the height of our privileges as God's people and the beginning of our heavenly reward. It is the foundation of all our relationships with God and with one another. God's name is our family name, the name by which we will be known through all eternity. What a privilege this is. We now bask in God's great love for us. It's one of the greatest privileges that's been given to human beings. We were adopted into his family. We were under the law, miserable, and under the power of the devil. Then Jesus came in the fullness of time, and at just the right time, in just 3 years of ministry. Among other things, he raised Lazarus from the dead, he fed 5,000. He even knocked Paul off the horse to get his attention, and he became such a prolific apostle. He showed us how to live. And today he leads us, cares for us like the great shepherd of his chair cares for his sheep. He proved his love for us by bearing terrible, painful, and horrible death to all, only to rise again. Because of all this, we have salvation from sin and from death to all who put their trust in him. We call him brother. That's the gift we celebrate at Christmas. But the 2,000 years have passed, and we're still waiting for the second installment. We're waiting for Jesus to arrive again. Just as Jesus sent his son in the fullness of time for the first Christmas, he will do so again in a second installment. Jesus says in Revelation 21 that he's coming quickly, and we wait, and we wait. So what might we do while we wait? Well, we should pray, stay in the Word, live by the Ten Commandments, and love our neighbor. That's all given. But today, on New Year's Eve, 2023, isn't there something more? Let me ask you this. Have you made any New Year's resolutions yet? You know those things we really intend to do, but the list first gets misplaced, then it gets lost, and then it gets forgotten. Most frequently, those lists weren't that important anyway, right? What if we looked at those resolutions in a little different light this year? Have you ever heard of Jonathan Edwards? He was born around the early 1700s and was a preacher. He's probably best known for a sermon he gave entitled Sinners in the Hand of an Angry God. But when he was 19 and uncertain of where life would lead, he began writing some guidelines for himself in his diary. He would later call these 70 guidelines his resolutions, and they acted as a compass for the early years as a pastor. These are not necessarily specifically New Year's resolutions, but as the new year comes upon us, we can look to them to perhaps to chart a direction for us in the new year. His resolutions fell under one of the following headings: overall life missions, good works, time management, relationships, suffering, character, or the one that had the most resolutions associated with it, spiritual life. Edward then pledged to read the list of resolutions once a week. He kept them before himself all the time. I wonder what it would be like if we put together some resolutions that focused our eyes on God rather than on ourselves. Maybe if one of our resolutions was to spend time in God's Word each day, rather than a resolution to get that next promotion. You got to remember, it's hard to get in shape spiritually when you only work out on Sunday. Perhaps if one of our resolutions was to find a charity where we could donate our talents, rather than be in the gym 3 times per week, we could be showing people Jesus so that more might be looking forward to the day he returns. These do not have to be great grand gestures. I have friends in this church, who have recognized a couple of things that have changed their lives since COVID, and they want to go back to what they were doing before. What does that look like? Well, for them, it means saying good morning to strangers. It also means making a practice to hold the door open for someone as they go in and out of the stores. See what I'm getting at? If our focus is on Jesus and living for him, I believe that many of the things in our world that are so negative but occupy so much of our energy and thinking would, for each of us, perhaps fall by the wayside, maybe just a little. And maybe, just maybe, we would be moving closer to the fullness of time, doing our part to move closer to the return of Jesus. Not a bad way to approach the new year. Not a bad goal for us all. I wish you all joy and peace in 2024. Amen. Won't you rise for our song, "The Squalor of a Borrowed Stable"?
Let's remain standing and boldly confess our faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed. We confess. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and descended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead. whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated as we bring our blessings now before our God in a time of offering. Roger, let's pray. Lord, this morning we bring before you just a portion of that which you have blessed us with. May we use these, our offerings, that we at Grace might be a blessing to those around us, that others might know in the fullness of time you sent us a Savior, that all of us would be known to be sons and daughters of God. So use these, our gifts, to that end, for our families, for our community, and for our world. We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, in our thoughts and prayers this morning as we gather as God's family, brothers and sisters in Christ, adopted into his family, we have some family to be praying for. Two families that are in the midst of grief and had loved ones who have died will be praying for the Sarver family. Ernie Sarver, the brother of Ken, passed away yesterday after a short battle with lung cancer. We're also going to be remembering and praying for the family of Lisa Hendricks, her mom. Laura Dickinson passed away, and so we pray God's peace and comfort to both the Sarver and the Hendricks family. We're praying for healing and God's peace in the midst of those who are going through some times of ill health. We're going to be praying for Kathy Warren, for God's strength in the midst of her health struggles. And also, we're praying for God's peace and presence to be with Mark Klosterman. That's the brother of Paul. Mark has now been placed in hospice care. With all of that said, let's stand for prayer. To our Abba, Father, in the fullness of time, you gave us Jesus to redeem us, to give us the gift of adoption as your children, heirs. Thank you for such a gift. May we, by your Spirit, hold Christ in our hearts today and always. And Lord, we pray that you would lead your church, that all Christians would embrace this Christ child by word and faith. And Lord, we pray for those who don't know that embrace. We pray for those who have lost their faith, have wandered from their faith. Lord, would you, by your Spirit, draw them near to you. Use us and whatever, whoever else, to draw them closer, to bring them back to faith by your Spirit and gift. And Holy God, mighty Lord, you have given power to the nations and to those who govern for the good of people. Bless our president, Congress, governor, and all of our leaders, that justice may prevail and people would be free to live at peace with all. And at a time when family and friends gather to bring in the new year, gracious Lord, receive our prayers for those who suffer loneliness. Comfort them with the sure and certain knowledge that you will never leave them or forsake them. You are our Emmanuel, God with us. Give to the lonely family and friends within the household of faith with whom they can find loving companionship. And Lord, we pray that you would help the sick and suffering. Pray for Mark and Kathy. Surround them with your love in Christ according to your good and gracious will. Heal them. Comfort those who mourn, Lord. We pray for the Sarver and Hendricks families. Fill their hearts with a certain hope of the resurrection. Your love is stronger than death because it's who you are as the resurrection and life. And Lord, you are the giver of every good gift. We thank you for this year now ending. We pray that you would forgive our sins where we have done wrong, work in our hearts true repentance and faith. Redeem us from all the evil of this past year. And so, Lord, we look forward now to the coming year. We commend to your blessing and love all that is to come. Until you bring this life on earth to an end, guard and guide us by your strong arm. Lead us according to your word. Renew us with clean hearts to trust and show love toward our neighbor. And Lord God, Heavenly Father, abide among us in this new year with your Spirit, that we may always trust in your saving name, the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit. You are one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's stand for God's blessing and benediction as we go our way into this new year. Now, may God dismiss his servants in peace with a spirit-filled heart that sings of our great Redeemer. My soul exults in my God. I rejoice greatly in the Lord. With hearts rejoicing, let's sing our closing song. Hark, the herald angels sing.